Natasha Wilson. I'm the executive editor for Harlequin Teen, and I'm here today at New York Comic Con 2013 with my fabulous author, Amalie Howard. She has written the first book in the Aquarathi series, Waterfell, and we're here today to talk a little bit about Amalie and her story. So, Amalie, tell us a little bit about your journey to publication and how Waterfell came about.
I've always been a writer. I was published poetry when I was 12, and I also entered a global youth writing competition when I was 15. But when I went to college, I kind of took a different direction, traveled a bit, and then, you know, wrote my first novel in 2009, which was published by an independent small press in 2011. I worked on building my social brand and really getting my name out there, and then I wrote several more novels, one of which was Waterfell, which was sold to the most amazing editor in the world.
She's being kind. So a lot of people will assume a story about an underwater shape-shifting princess is about mermaids, and that is not the case with Waterfell. So tell us a little bit about the Aquarathi, the series, and what readers can expect from Waterfell.
Okay. I knew that I wanted to write an ocean-themed novel, but, you know, mermaids, it's part of pop culture, it's been done, and I wanted to do something that was different, but also something that was beautiful. So I came up with the idea of the Aquarathi, you know, these underwater alien sea monster type creatures that are living in secret in the world's oceans. And then I wanted to take that further and say, what if these creatures could shift into human form? And that's how that idea of the Aquarathi came about. And Waterfell, you know, is about a girl who is one of those creatures, but also running away from herself, trying to be, you know, a human girl.
Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the heart of Waterfell. But is there more that's kind of the heart of what Waterfell's about, and what was your inspiration behind the story and the whole series?
So the main protagonist in Waterfell, Nerissa, is trying to figure out whether she wants to assume her throne and defend her crown or run away and hide in the human world because it's safe. So the heart of Waterfell is really this girl's journey to sort of find herself and accept who she is and the duty and the, you know, her destiny that she's been born into. The inspiration for Waterfell came from reading great books. I knew I wanted to do something different. I wanted a strong female character, a strong lead. But I also wanted a girl that was flawed. You know, and the reason I wanted to write someone who had fatal flaws was to have her corrected by the end of the book, to have some character growth. And I think Nerissa does achieve that.
She absolutely does. She's one of my favorite heroines. She has a great character arc in this story. So when you're writing speculative fiction, of course, a big part of writing speculative fiction is world building and making your reader suspend disbelief and believe in this fantasy world you're creating. So what's your process for building the world, and how did you come up with the Aquarathi, aliens coming down to our world and making their home on Earth?
You mean besides flying by the seat of my movie-loving pants?
Exactly. Tell us your author secrets.
You know, everything comes from research. And with the Aquarathi, I wanted to come out of some basis of truth. So for the world building, I came up with the idea of using mosasaurs, which are extinct marine reptiles.
Oh,
and,
wow.
You know, I asked myself the question, what if on another planet that was similar to ours, I mean, space is huge. We don't know if other planets like Earth do exist. What if there was this mosasaur species evolved into something intelligent? You know, what if they lived with us, you know, hominids like us? And then, you know, it kind of just a series of questions. What happened if the hominids decided they wanted to enslave the Aquarathi, and all of a sudden their planet becomes poisoned and unhealthy? And what if they came here? So, I mean, it's all kind of like a process of asking yourself what if questions. And then the world of Waterfell, which is underwater, it's, you know, I kind of went off the Mariana Trench, which is the deepest part of the world's oceans. That's where they have their home. And it's about, you know, it's not like Disney princess type, you know, beautiful underwater castle. It's more like caves. I envision it having a lot of light from minerals. You know, they're bioluminescent creatures, so maybe it shimmers off their bodies. So, yeah, kind of just rolled with it a little.
Well, I think it worked for you. Now, we all know many great heroes have great sidekicks. And Nerissa is strong and powerful in her own right, but she has a best friend named Jenna, who's one of my very favorite characters in the book. And Jenna's often the perfect voice of reason when Nerissa is getting a little ahead of herself. And just tell us about their friendship and loyalty and how important that is to this story.
You know, I really, really love Jenna as a character. I think she's just, she's fun, she's smart. She's what the perfect friend should be. And I think Nerissa, being what she is, this sort of ruthless alien from another planet, finding this human who's completely accepting of her no matter what, there's something special about that bond, that friendship. And I think when Nerissa does reveal herself to Jenna, the fact that she, you know, she's afraid, but she still accepts her because she knows the girl inside, as opposed to this big, scaly, monstrous creature. I think there's something special about that. And the friendship element, for me, was a really important part of this book.
Well, I love it. I think Jenna's is really adds something, again, special to this. Now, the other part that adds something extra special to Waterfell, and again, I think the Comic-Con audience will appreciate that behind every great hero is a great villain who is depth and motivation and challenges the hero to become more than they ever thought they could be. So I would love for you to tell our audience a little more about the antagonist that Nerissa faces in Waterfell.
Okay. I was going to say that the Comic-Con audience is perfect, like, because they're the people that will know that the right villain will make a book or a movie or anything like that better. Because if you don't have the right villain, it's just not going to work. In Nerissa's case in Waterfell, I wanted to go with two different types. One is in her human guise, a girl that sort of mirrors who she is and the, you know, the bad things about herself that she'd like to change. And then on the flip side of it, I have Amora, who is Akarothi, and she has different, you know, she a whole different intent for what she wants to achieve with the human world. But she's not exactly evil. She's just out for the greater good, and she'll do anything she can to defend her people, protect her people, even at the cost of killing us all. And the great thing about
she will.
The great thing about a good antagonist is they force the protagonist to do what they have to do to be better, to change.
Yep.
With the character at school, Nerissa looks at her and says, oh my gosh, I don't want to be this girl. And then with the big bad, she's forced to change herself to defend her people. Which is, you know, she has to seek to find the balance between killing all the humans, you know, and taking over our planet, or living with us, coexisting with humans.
Yeah. Well, it's a magnificent story. And just to finish up, I'd love to just hear anything else that you feel Comic-Con and the people here would like to know about this series and maybe interest them in checking it out.
You know, apart from it being awesome,
it really is. It's so much fun.
There's a great male hero in it. You know, he's a great romantic lead. He's a great partner for Nerissa. There's a lot of secrets there. I also think that, you know, it's a very unique story just because it's about sea monsters and something different. It's about, you know, there's surfing in it. There's a lot of different layered characters. And then my favorite thing about it, it's about, you know, think sea dragons. Who doesn't love beautiful, gorgeous, intelligent, deadly, you know, dragons?
Absolutely. And who wouldn't want the ability to change into one?
Right.
I wish I could. Absolutely just love the ocean elements in this book and the surfing. And I think you actually have surfed.
I have surfed.
You do surfing,
I love surfing
too.
So, I mean, a lot of that did come from some experience. I'm not great, but, you know, I can hold my own on a board. Yeah.
Terrific. Well, we really appreciate the opportunity to talk today. Amalie herself is an amazing person. She has fenced competitively. She has surfed. She's jumped off the Macau Tower in China, bungee jumped, not just jumped.
Clearly, I'm a thrill seeker.
And she has a Harley Davidson Nightster bike.
Yes.
So not your average author, not your average book. We hope people will check out Waterfell, and it was really great to have the opportunity to talk with you, Amalie, today.
Thanks for having me.